but I think it will work. I don't have to give a demo or so. So, yeah, who am I? Am I nuts or am I a geek? Am I nuts or am I a professional? So a story about Venus and Mars, open source versus commercial, the good, the bad, and the ugly, and then a little bit more information. So I don't say much in this slide, but I hope you will stay with me. Actually, I included some small quiz, but I already gave the clue in the last presentation, so I'm just going to over it. This is a guy called Jay Miner, and this is the Juggler demo that was run on a computer, and it was from the 80s, 90s. That's the logo of the company. This is a famous demo that was given. So they demonstrated the computer, and they presented all the features, and then afterward they break down a screen and there was a bouncing ball during the whole presentation, and that was really an amazement. So, and I'm talking about an Amiga here. So that was actually the first multimedia computer ever generated. So I'm coming from that scene, and I've been involved. When the company bankrupt, I was involved in an open source version of the Amiga OS. And actually, I'm still following it. I'm not actively contributing anymore. I also followed very closely the Linux. So from the software side, I looked really at open source and I also looked at how the companies made money with that. That's why I want to give this presentation on what are the business models for open source, and or give you how I see the world, because I don't want to claim that I have a view on the whole world. I'm just one small part of it and I look from a certain angle, and everybody does, I think. But I want to give you my view. Not so professional. I work at IMEC, already told it before, and that is you have the IC Link group that actually does services for everything from RTL to GDS. So if you have questions on that, I can give you contact in my company. I'm not doing the contact with the customers. I'm actually involved in a standard cell library design and SRAM design for space. So we do ESA, so radiation hardened standard cells. So in that way, I know a little bit about digital logic and how an implementation flow works, because you can make a standard cell, but if you don't provide a liberty with it, I think the backend cannot do anything with it. So and then one of these is IC manufacturing, so that we also provide through us access to multi-project wafers, so that you can regroup things and we. Like I said before, if you're below 1,000 wafers, the foundries typically don't do it themselves, or the big foundries, and they go through service companies as we are. The talks I do here are impersonal and not from IMEC point of view. Open source versus commercial. So I don't know if this, maybe I should have put two equal signs there to look it more like Verilog. But is open source is not the opposite of is commercial. So you can have proprietary commercial things, you can have open source commercial things, and the vice versa. Some companies try to put open source as a opposite of commercial. You had that back in the day when Linux started, you had the Unix vendors that also sold their compilers for big money. And they say, yeah, we are professional and that the hippies are doing Linux. But time has proven that Linux was the right thing. And Unix, that's only a very few people who still use it. Everything except desktop, I think, is now Linux. The main, you have your cell phone, except for Apple, that's a different story. So the good, the bad, and the ugly I want to talk about is from a business model that works. So it's not, it doesn't have to be that it has to be open source. So just a business model that works. So the bad. So open source as a free resource, so that you have this sales guy, they say, yeah, we take the open source and we try to legally do it in such a way that we don't have to give anything back. typically this doesn't work, or you get sued. And from ethical point of view, I think that's not the way to do it. But that's my opinion. The next bad is OS as a last resort to build market free labor. So you have a failed product, which is proprietary, and then you open source it, and then you hope you get a big community that will help you save your product. Doesn't work. I think no company has done that. If you say, yeah, I will stop this project, and you say, I will just open source it so that other people can use it, I think that's a good thing to do. And then you will see if they will use it or not. But they will not help you to save your company, your business. The ugly. So the open core. So that means the company is doing the basic thing, which is the open source, and then they build prepared things on top of it for which you have to pay. You find that in web services, you find that a lot. But that doesn't work that good. I will come back to that later on at the end of my talk. But often these companies then switch back to a fully, what they have open sourced, they then go to clusters again, and they have these big horror stories of open source doesn't work and all these things. But I will explain later what I think that is. The good. So that's from a business point of view. You have the classical proprietary commercial things. You have the classical software, Microsoft, Oracle, SAP, all the big vendors. They make big money, and they have proven business models. You have then all studies that you can do. So personally, I'm not. Why? Okay, but yeah, but they try to make it as, But they're a desktop system, then desktop system of Microsoft. So, and also from most of the ASIC you are produced now or proprietary commercial things. Because it costs a lot of money, you have to be able to earn back your money. So it's understandable that you do it that way. Although in my previous talk, I explained that they also want to get more to this open source commercial thing. The good, you have then what they call the benevolent dictators for life. So the people who start doing things just because they want to do something, and then in the end, they end up as the guy who decides what goes in and out, and you have then the Linux with Linus Torvalds, Perl, Python, and that are examples. And typically these people don't have an own company. They are either academic or paid by a foundation or so, so that they can work independently from the commercial use of the product. This is a more, what also happens is that you have a non-competitive base, but you can have competitive products on top of that. They can either be proprietary or open source. And I think that also can be a good business model. For example, the Linux distributions. They are commercial. Most of the time, they are open source. What I see now is that Red Hat is taken as, in the EDA world, as a reference of what they want to be with open source. But you have to remember one thing. Red Hat has open sourced everything they have bought. So they are not doing open core type of things. And the most of the business models I see, there is some proprietary thing also, making money on proprietary IPs and all these things. And I have my questions about the business model, but did you say it's open source, but you still want to earn money on, again, on the open core type of thing. Another one is that you have the Android phones, which I consider more as, you have Linux itself, which is open source, but Android from Google is as a BSD license, and they have sometimes not released for certain version of their Android system. So then it's kind of more priority than open source. You can also have the same with services. You have the OpenStack. You have originally you had Amazon, which had their own system to make virtual machines. And then some competitors came together and they built OpenStack, which by cooperating on them, they wanted to compete with Amazon. And their things on top, they have their own system, Rackspace, IBM, implementation of using, but the basis is shared, and the people working on that, they work on making OpenStack better without looking too much on the requirements of each of the companies on top of it. And that's the golden rule, and that's the big difference to me between open core, where you have this interrelation between the base and the service on top. I hope. Yeah, okay. And then you also have the open source, the maker movement now, which can be commercial or non-hobby. You have maybe makers, but they are typically open source minded. What is often said there, information wants to be free. I put it a little bit on priority because maybe some people just don't care about licensing, and so then it's very difficult because you don't know if you can reuse it. So that's then maybe a weaker point. So to conclude my talk, actually my question is open. I'm going to focus a little bit more on what I call the corporates, so the big companies who need to spend a lot, and then the makers. And I see makers more in the open source commercial thing. So if we talk about business models, we focus on the commercial thing, we don't consider the non-profit of hobby here. So you have the makers from Venus and the corporates from Mars. And I will do a black and white analysis in a world with 50 shades of gray. I like to sometimes put things black and white, but of course in reality you have different things, but that can maybe start a discussion. So corporates, you have this growth, revenue and profit, which is very important for them. Makers, they just want to solve. They have a thing that the problem they want to solve and then scratch an itch. And if somebody else has solved the problem, they will move to something else. They will not start competing, or most of the time they won't compete. They will cooperate. So that's the next thing. Corporate is competition. Be better as a competitor. So you can call that alpha, male or female. And then makers is more about community, beta, male or female. So also corporates, it's get very rich. So the purpose is to make as much money as possible. So that's one of the reasons they say for the purpose of making companies is to earn as much as possible. So like I said, I'm exaggerating things. And a maker, yeah, he needs to have money to feed his children, his wife, but if he can do that, then he will be happy. So then you also have, in corporates, you have roadmaps, business plans, people with MBAs. Then one thing that you often see in the maker world is that they have a problem, they have an idea, a solution, then something magic, and then maybe we make a profit. When I talk to the salespeople, I'm not going to specify which ones, they often say, yeah, there is no free lunch. So they see strategy behind everything. So if somebody gives you something for free, they must have a reason for that. And people, makers or more, with a big community, we can prepare a cheap lunch and why we can enjoy it. So corporates, you have investors, return investments. make it is a labor of love. And then recently you have done the crowdfunding, which is, like I said in my previous talk, something that I think for the maker world is a nice thing. And then you also have the corporates, NDA, and all the legal stuff, and then the makers, the information wants to be free. So, and the last thing is that you have this open core, and I think where the problem is that typically you have your investors who want to have a return investment, so depending on much money you got from investing, but they are the boss of your company. Yeah? So if they don't like what you do, they will steer you in another way. If they don't think that open source is good for you, they will move you away from open source. And if you do open core, you have to have a community. If you do all the work yourself anyway, why then open source it? But if you want to have a community, you have to make the community happy. But the community doesn't want to feel that they are working for you to sell you your products. And I think there the problem with open core is. Okay, so my summary is, maybe I picked this Mars and Venus comparison because I think it's not something that you can learn. I think it's how you are built. If you're a maker, you won't become a CEO of a corporate, I think, and the other way around. That's how I see it. I'm feeling myself more on the maker side, and I don't think I will ever be a CEO of a 1,000 company. And so you have to pick the business model that fits best with your nature. And trying to mix business models is, in my opinion, the most difficult. And you should really pick one and then go for it. Okay. Thank you for listening. Questions?
Okay, can you go back one slide, I think?
By the open core?
Yeah. One. Back. Yeah. Oh, here, perfect. So here we have roadmap, business plan, MBA, blah blah.
Yeah.
And on the other side, we have problem, idea, solution, and so on. In fact, I think that for makers communities, it would be good to have some kind of plan and a direction. Because if you do a small project on your own, it's okay to do whatever with it. But once you start involving other people, then it would be good that the boat goes in one direction and everyone rows in the correct direction, not goes in different ways, each one of them. And this is something that, now who takes the role to, probably it's a shared role, right? So it's not like we have a CEO and the CEO, like a skipper, says, okay, we go that direction. Probably it's a shared role into the community to decide which way they go. And so this is not in a way, they are not contradicting. This is what I want to say.
Yeah, I partly agree with you, but it has to be natural. It has to be naturally with how the whole infrastructure, how the email work, the mailing list work, so that people are nice to each other and that things can come up there. I don't think you can really organize it with meetings. We are going to decide.
No, not in that sense. Not in that sense. Although if you look at the RISC-V foundation, they have meetings and so forth. So it's quite organized. I mean, to be organized, to have some kind of basic management is not contradictory to the nature of open source or to the...
Well, but what I agree is that if you want to build a community, you have to be able to listen to people and understand what their things is and try to work to find solutions for them and not only for you. I agree. And that you are not very rude against people, try to be friendly to people. I agree with that. And that's not always the case. I agree also with that. Yeah.
Sorry,
I
just wanted to add a thought about that. Earlier in the day, we had the question like, what can we do to increase the quality of the course that we have on the open source community? And I reckon that with your comment, you just have highlighted the challenge that we have now as a community to step up the things that we do, you know. And if we really want to increase the quality and take it to the next level and to be able to use these kind of things in space and whatever, we have to recognize the challenge and the fact that, yeah, we have to get organized and, you know, we cannot just do whatever we want to do on a weekend or whatever. Obviously, you can do and take your project, you know, the way you want, but depending on how serious or stable you needed it to be, then you have to step it up. And we as a community, we have to step it up and recognize that, yeah, we don't need, you know, I don't know, roadmaps and business plans or whatever, but you have to recognize the fact that you need some more structure. Yeah, so it's just, yeah, so it's just food for thought, really, what I want to say, but yeah.
What is also so is you will always have intense moments in a project so that people have different opinions. And at certain points, you will need to decide to split. So I think forking is one of the important things of open source. I don't know if you about this, about GCC, you had at one time the EGCS, that split off from GDC, and then later on was merged again. Also, the Android patches that Google maintained also were seen by the other Linux kernel developers as we don't want to touch it. Until that Linux says, enough people are now using that, so I want to get it into the kernel. So you have to be community building, but sometimes you also have to have a vision and have two visions and develop them in parallel. But what's the best way? I don't know. And also what I want to add is that in an open source world, these differences, or for the whole world, you have also these differences in corporates, but they keep them inside. You don't see them. There you have the marketing people that gives a good view on the company, and you don't have that in open source. And that's a good way to attack also open source. But
I guess it's just a kind of observation. I don't really know the best way to phrase it without it sounding trolly. But I guess having worked in commercial environments, it's very apparent there that the copyleft style stuff is generally incredibly toxic. And it's almost a shame how much stuff there is available where presumably the authors want things to be reused that you just can't touch with a barge pole if you intend to do anything commercial with it at all. And I almost feel that harms kind of almost like hobby makers who want to try and create a kind of the don't starve to death type situation where they're making a bit from their stuff because you pretty much have to use kind of completely free things like Mit or BSD or do it all yourself because it's very hard to charge for a product if it involves open source stuff.
Yeah.
And it kind of, it feels like almost like it pins into either a hobbyist market or someone that can get kind of external funding from somewhere else. So it almost feels like in some sense, it kind of pushes it away from the middle ground where people could coexist.
Interesting discussion because I am preferring copyleft over permissive licenses. So it works for Linux.
Yeah.
So when I make something, I feel I have the right to say, you can use my thing, but you have to give everything back what you do with my thing.
Yeah.
Of course, if you don't do that, then you have to do it yourself. So that's the other side of the story. Yeah. And
what I'm actually thinking about is actually very small components of things generally. So, like, there's quite a few, well, particularly in the library scene, there's loads of open source libraries that do one specific thing, like, I don't know, parsing JPEGs or PNGs or stuff. And it's almost a shame that all these things exist that then can't be touched. And I guess it's similar with cores, where, like, you've got a UART. It's like we're saying there's hundreds of UART implementations. The reason is, well, one of the reasons is everyone has to create their own, because other people create them and then drop them out as GPL. Maybe, yeah.
No, and also because our RTL coding is not really good at making reusable code, or the way we use it.
Yeah.
But that's another story.
Yeah. So I just find, as a maker hobbyist myself, I personally won't touch GPL stuff if there's any chance I might want to consider selling it in the future, just because it's not even worth trying to use that and then getting rid of it later. So I end up reinventing stuff as an open source enthusiast that already exists.
That's your opinion, because you think that you cannot sell GPL code. And what I want to say, that doesn't have to be key, but it's much more difficult, I agree.
Yeah.
But that's your choice. But I don't want to blame the guys who put it at GPL.
No, I don't blame them.
That's your choice.
I'll just say there's plenty of examples of people selling GPL license code out there. I mean, Richard Stallman, you can go back to the very start of GPL. Richard Stallman used to sell copies of Emacs on tape for $100 a tape, I think. You know, it's not an incompatible thing, and it's actually happening more and more in a lot of business cases, where people are producing open source and then selling the service, and people are still buying that stuff because they want the support and they want this. You know, it's almost easier than it ever has been, because the artificial distinction between, as you very rightly pointed out, the artificial distinction between proprietary and between commercial and open source is now, at least in the generalized cloud software world, is completely understood. You know, people are very happy to have something that is GPL and pay for it. So, I mean, in a lot of ways, a lot of this is like the hardware world being a bit behind the software world, as it has been always, right?
I will be a bit rude here. I know this is a very interesting discussion. The thing is, it's a bit too interesting, knowing by experience, licensing, permissive copyleft licenses discussions can take probably weeks. So I will have to cut this off here.